My name is Elizabeth Nielson, and I'm part of the NYU psilocybin research team. As Jeff said, I'm actually trained to become a therapist on the ongoing alcohol trial. That's a phase two clinical trial of psilocybin-assisted treatment of alcohol dependence, as well as developing a couple of qualitative research studies surrounding that work, one of which I'm going to tell you about today. By way of introduction, the study that I'm presenting today, I'm working on with Jeff Guss and Stephen Ross from NYU, as well as Honoria Guarano from National Development and Research Institute, where I have a fellowship, an NIH-funded grant in order to support my time, so that's supporting my work, as well as this presentation has received some help from the Open Foundation in order to be here. So I'm not selling anything. I don't have any money to make off of this, any conflict of interest. So just to recap, we're talking about a qualitative study here that is investigating how psychedelic therapists, psilocybin therapists, conduct their work. How do they engage in that therapy? What is it that they do? What do they bring to the room? We've talked about a training model for how to help develop psilocybin-assisted therapists, how for them to develop their therapy. But we thought it'd be interesting to do a study where we actually talk to the therapists and find out from their perspective, how does this therapy work? So psilocybin-assisted therapy, when we talk about it for the purposes of this research, we're talking about therapy that includes both the preparatory sessions, being with the patient during the dosing sessions, the medication sessions, usually running debriefing sessions, and then integration sessions. And in the different models, different research studies, there can be some overlap. For instance, if there are several medication sessions, some of the sessions in between, some of the therapy in between may be part integration and part preparation. But those are sort of the four basic components that I'm talking about when I'm talking about psilocybin-assisted therapy. We know that in the United States, where we're working, similar therapy is being tested for the existential anxiety, as well as for several addictive disorders. And those are really the therapists that we're going to be talking about. So a little background, most of the main outcomes that people are looking at in large research studies, they're talking about sort of a placebo versus treatment condition. So you've got a control condition, you've got a treatment condition, and the main outcome differences, the results, are seen as the difference between whether or not the person got the medication or not, right? That's what it's attributed to. So you've got psychotherapy plus medicine, you've got results, maybe you've got psychotherapy plus a placebo and no results or different results, right? That's where the main change is attributed to. What we really think is, and what Jeff touched on just now, is that the medicine works in the context of the psychotherapy. So what we're actually seeing is the effect of the medicine in the space that is co-created between the therapist and the patient. This isn't a simple additive process where you've got therapy plus drug equals results. This is a blending process, a mixing process, something more than a whole that is more than the sum of its parts, if you will. So our project is to conduct this exploratory study, exploratory interview study, with experienced psychedelic therapists. When I say experienced psychedelic therapists, we're choosing to work with therapists that have had at least 15 sessions, that have conducted at least 15 psilocybin sessions, in order to make sure that we're really tapping people that have a significant amount of personal experience providing sessions. And they can base what they're saying on that personal experience. And the idea behind this is to determine from the therapist's perspective how psychedelic therapy works, right? So we can come up with a lot of ideas about it, we can come up with analogies, we can say we think it works akin to the way psychoanalysis works, we think it works in a similar way to some other things, we can say we think that it works because of what's happening on a neurological level. We want to actually understand from the therapist's perspective how does this work. We're using qualitative methodology. We think that this is fitting because our questions are really open-ended. We don't don't know how it works. We want to explore how it works, and we want to generate some hypotheses that we can then later perhaps go out and test. We want to try to generate a model, generate some hypotheses. We consider the therapist to be this key population. They have unique experience. They've been doing a certain number of sessions. They're in a place to make sort of intimate personal observations of what works, how the therapy works, and to perhaps to generate some ideas that again can be sort of vetted and tested in future models. And the qualitative methodology that we will use, it'll be a phenomenological interpretive analysis, which allows us to, in a very sort of formal, organized way, to distill the experiences of several therapists who have all experienced a similar phenomenon into one sort of key description that is free from the trappings of just one therapist's experience or one therapist's story. So it's no longer just an anecdote. It's actually more like what you come out with is more like a conglomerate of the experience of several therapists who have experienced the same thing, and hopefully that is something that then can be translated and understood by future people trying to understand the same phenomena, right? We're getting away from the anecdotal story into what is really the core component that's left. So our specific aims, we want to highlight the role of the psychotherapy in the psilocybin-assisted treatment process. Like I said before, the main focus of a lot of the research has been on the medicine. What is the effect of the medicine? How much medicine? How long does the medicine work? What are the biological features of the medicine as it's metabolized? And we want to actually draw some attention to the psychotherapy process, to what these therapists are doing and how they're doing it. We want to describe how therapists conceptualize a couple of key psychotherapy phenomena, and I'm going to get to those on the next slide, exactly what some of those are. And we want to look at some of the training manuals that the manualized therapies that therapists are using, and talk to them about what they bring to those manuals. It's a big, especially my background is in addiction research, and so there's a lot of empirically supported treatments for addictions where therapists are asked to sort of translate a manualized therapy into practice. And there's always, the clinician's own personal take on that, the way that they actually use that manual. No two clinicians are going to do that the same, no two therapists are going to do that the same. Even though the therapy is standardized for the purpose of research, everybody's going to bring their own particular way to it. So we want to be able to talk to therapists about how do they actually use these manuals, hopefully so that we can better understand how to make those manuals the most helpful possible. And then another thing that we'd like to do is maybe be able to work on our preliminary model of how psilocybin-assisted psychotherapy works based on how the therapists see it as working. So the phenomenon that we want to talk to therapists about, the first six of these are really key phenomenon in the psychotherapy literature in general. They're not unique to psychedelic psychotherapy. So this will be a study, hopefully it'll be interest of people outside of the psychedelic psychotherapy world who are looking at this as just one other variation on a way to conduct psychotherapy. So things like alliance building, which we know is related to outcomes, how does transference work, how is the use of touch, what are boundaries, self-disclosure, how do all of those things sort of play out in the psychedelic psychotherapy situation. We'll also want to talk to therapists about how they work with and integrate difficult experiences. Again, something that manuals do seem to give a little bit of guidance on, but we expect that therapists have are going to bring their own touch to that. How do they work with those experiences such that they become points where the patient can integrate them and grow from them? So how does a study like this actually get carried out? It starts with recruitment. We contact principal investigators. We talk to them, some of them from already within our group. We request copies of manuals. We request to be in contact with the therapist. And I should mention that part of the way that the study like this is set up, in order to be rigorous and make sure that we are sampling our population in a fair way, is really putting the word out there so that anybody who is could potentially participate, receives the invitation and is actually invited to participate. So this isn't just like, oh, you know, these are the therapists that I know, so I'm going to interview them. We actually take precautions to make sure that there's sort of equal access to any therapist that would meet the inclusion criterion. After people receive an invitation and sign up, do an informed consent, the whole thing. We do some interviews. We'll be doing a semi-structured qualitative interviews, which will be audio recorded. At that time, those audio recordings will be transcribed and analyzed. We use qualitative data analysis software in order to organize those transcripts, in order to code them, in order to sort them, in order to be able to, for instance, look at comparisons between different subgroups of therapists, and so on and so forth. And that is essentially what will result in some of our findings. Hopefully we will be able to talk about putting forth some of these models of how some of these things in psychedelic therapy are actually working. Thank you.